accidents. I don't believe you're here by chance. I choose to believe you're here because it was the will of the Lord for you to be here. Amen. And I want you to add your faith with my faith that God is going to say something or do something that means something to you. Will you agree with that? Well, grab hands with the person next to you. Woo! Got that little jog right there. I need more cardio, Johnny. Father, we thank you today for your word. We thank you, Lord. Revelation knowledge shall flow freely, uninterrupted and unhindered by any satanic or demonic forces. I pray less of me and more of you, none of me and all of you. Think through my mind and speak through my vocal cords. Father, those things that you would have me to say to these your sheep. I thank you, Lord, you've anointed them with ears to hear, hearts to receive, and a spirit to contain your word. It's in the mighty, holy, all-knowing, all-powerful name of Jesus that we pray. I thank you, Lord. No one under the sound of my voice will sit here in discomfort or pain. You sent your word and it healed them. So, Lord, I thank you for emotional healing. I thank you for financial healing. I thank you for physical healing. Lord, I thank you for supernaturally healing relationships. We stand in agreement concerning these truths. And let all that agree shout amen. Amen. Well, give that good-looking person next to you a big old hug. There's somebody look good on the other side. Don't leave them out. Praise God. You know, somebody asked me once, so why you tell people, you know, give that good-looking person a hug? Because we don't let ugly people come to this church. There's an ugly barrier at the border. You didn't know it's a barrier. Ugly folk can't even come on the grounds. Yeah, they get put out. So you beautiful. Look at your neighbor and say, so you're beautiful if you're here. Praise God. Amen. We've been talking about focus on authentic Christianity. Focus on authentic Christianity. Being real. Look at your neighbor. It's time to be real. Out with the fake. Out with the phony. It's time to be real. Don't nobody like fake. What if you went to the International Mall? You went to the Louis Vuitton store. Paid $900 for a purse and discovered they gave you a fake one. What would you do? It'd be a problem. If you went to the flea market and you got you a Louis Vuitton purse and you paid $50 for it, you already know something up. I got a point to what I'm saying. So when you come to church, what's your expectation? And where do you believe the source of what you're about to hear coming from? Because if you believe it's from God, then you got to believe that the man or woman of God that's teaching you is authentic. I don't know fake preacher. Look at him. I don't want to hear no fake preacher. Because I don't want to end up a fake Christian. Amen. It's like computer programming, junk in, junk out. You see, that's why we focus on the word of God. Jesus said, man does not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. You don't need my opinion on how to live. You need God's word. And he's made it clear. Amen. So today we're going to set some things in order. And we're going to start in Matthew chapter 6. And it's very important that you listen and pay attention because, again, I believe this message today will help you, like it helped me, set things in their proper priority. Amen? Matthew chapter 6. Hallelujah. Because I'm convinced this year, 2017, will be your best year ever. Now, let's start at verse 32. He says, for after all these things, do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. Now, the Amplified makes it even plainer. He says, watch this. I'm going to start at verse 31. He said, therefore, do not worry or be anxious, saying, what are we going to have to eat, or what are we going to have to drink, or what are we going to have to wear? For the Gentiles, heathens, see that in parentheses? He said, heathens always concerned about what they're going to wear. Heathens always worried about what they're going to have to eat. Heathens always worried about what clothes they got to wear. He said, and I know you need to eat. You need a place to stay. You need a car. You need clothing. I know what your needs are too. He said, but I have a better way for you to obtain those things than the heathens. The problem is we as Christians, we're our expectation is just like the heathens. And there's a reason why. Tell them you're at church. They knew you really well, they know that, right? He says, for the Gentiles, heathens, wish for, crave, and diligently seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows well that you need them all. You need the same stuff heathens do, but the way you and I, as children of God, are to acquire these things should be different. Matter of fact, our focus should be different. He's saying these things shouldn't take priority in our life like heathens. You know, if you call folk what they really are, God calls them heathens. You go to your job, you see unsaved people, and you say, good morning, heathen. You better be ready to fight. I mean, it just kind of, it lets you know there's a distinction. You know, we kind of colored up everything. We made bad sound good. We made things that are not right. We prettied it up. Like, he or she is very promiscuous. No, he a hoe. She a hoe. What's up, hoe? Now, if you said that, you better be ready to fight. Some of y'all look at me like you're shocked. What? No, part of our problems is our perception. We're not looking at things the way God wants us to look at things. Here's what he said in the next verse. But seek, aim at, strive after, first of all. Everybody say first. So we got to put first things first. He said, for a believer, we're not aiming at or focus on. That's what, in order to aim at something, you have to focus on it. You have to place your attention on that. It has to take priority over everything else. He said, that's what heathens do. When a heathen want a car, they don't focus on the Lord. They focus on the car. When the heathen want a house, they don't focus on the Lord. They focus on the house. When a heathen hungry, they focus on the food, not the provider of the food. I mean, the source of the thing for a believer is more important than the thing. Let me say it another way. Where the resource comes from for a believer is more important than the resource. God said, if you need money, don't look at money, look at me. First things first. Our problem as Christians, God's not first anymore. your job first, your man first, your woman first, your children first. Where is God on your list of priorities? How far down on that list has he dropped? Now, there's a saying I believe. If Jesus is not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all, because he's not playing second fiddle to nothing. Got real serious for a minute, didn't it? Mm-hmm. It is serious. Listen to this. But seek. Don't be like the heathens. This is what we do as believers. But seek, aim at, strive after, first of all, his kingdom and his righteousness. And in parentheses, it tells you what he means by that. His way of doing and being right. His way of doing it. Not your way of doing it. His way of doing it. Our biggest problem today is we all got ideas. We all got ways we think it ought to be done. Matter of fact, the last bad decision you made it. The consequences of that decision, you still paying for it. Because it was your decision. God said, I have a better plan for you. I have a better way for you. Matter of fact, my way is higher than your ways. My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. But seek, aim at, strive after, first of all, his kingdom, his righteousness, his way of doing and being right. And then, watch this, all these things, everybody say things are things. See, we don't need to get deep and religious. Things are things. And he's made it real plain. Look, let me tell you, heathens are not seeking how to worship God. He said, same thing the heathens seeking. You need all that. He said, but I don't want you to seek it. I don't want you to focus on that. I don't want you to aim at that the way they do. And he said, if you place me first, here's what he's going to do. And then all these things taken together will be given you besides. You know, some of y'all are working for stuff that God wants to bless you with if you just put him first. And then some of y'all are working trying to earn money to buy stuff that can only come from God. Because money is a pitiful, pitiful substitute for the blessing. Money is a pitiful, pitiful substitute for peace. You can't make enough money to buy joy. Are you with me so far? You can't. I don't care how big your house is. I don't care what you put in it. If Jesus is not there, and if Jesus is not first there, you got a problem. I don't care what kind of car you drive. If Jesus is not Lord of the driver, doesn't matter how you're rolling, brother, it's a fool rolling. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And I'm speaking to Christians. We've placed God behind a bunch of stuff. Yeah, I know people have a problem. They would have no problem spending $3,000 a month on a car note. So they could ride in a Rolls, but wouldn't give $50 to the church. But they say they're Christian. Priorities out of order. Oh, come on, now you don't make it about money. Everything with most of y'all is about money. That's why you go to work. You don't go to work because you love your career. Let them folks stop paying you. Go tomorrow and let them tell you You know, we love you. We're so happy you're here. You do such a wonderful job, but we ain't going to be able to pay you no more. How long you going to keep going? Do you love the job? No, you don't. Spread them snowflakes somewhere else. They ain't going to last in Florida, amen? So how do you know when he's first or you place him somewhere else on your list of priorities? The next verse tell you where God really is in your life. So do not worry or be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will have worries and anxieties of its own. Sufficient for each day is its own trouble. What's that mean? Well, very simple. If you trust in God, and you're totally trusting God, you've made him first priority. He said, well, here's the first evidence that you have me in the right place in your life. There's no need to worry nor fear of anything, so there's no point of worry. That's why I always say, pray about everything, worry about nothing. Why? God is first. The Bible says in Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Now, God dealt with me yesterday on my way to church last night about that scripture. Well, not that one, but another one. But it fits. So I'm riding to church, and God says, when you make your budget your priority, you're not trusting me. I said, what do you mean? He said, you cannot experience the manifestation of Ephesians 3:20 when you govern your life based on your budget. He said, because Ephesians 3:20, here's what it says. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think, infinitely beyond your highest prayers, thoughts, hopes, or dreams. That's not your budget. That's way beyond your budget. He said, so if you limit your life to your budget, that's your plan, not mine. I ain't saying don't budget. I'm just saying don't put it, don't make it a priority over God. All right, y'all looking at me like I'm crazy. Like, where is man getting this stuff from? Okay, go to Proverbs chapter 16. And this is why if you don't believe the word, trust the word, really don't do you any good to come to this church. It really don't. And that's why some people left. It's the truth. But I don't think Pastor Paul knows what he's talking about. Throw your Bible away then. I'm just reading it. Amen. This scripture right here, I'm going to read it from the Amplified. Proverbs 16, verse 1. It will absolutely, absolutely change your thinking relative to your thoughts and your plans. Because it changed mine. I know a lot of y'all are smart. Really, we got a lot of intelligent people in here. But if so, I know. Not one of y'all is smarter than God. Mm-mm. I don't care how many degrees you got. Next time you got some issues, go to your wall, pray to your plaque, and see if you get some answers. Ain't nothing coming out of that paper that you hung on that wall. Now, I'm not disparaging education. It's very important. I'm educated. That's how I know how to read. And I know how to study. Amen? Been had a library card since I was 10. I got thousands of books. I've written 38 books. So I'm not telling you not to be educated. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. I'm just saying your education is not superior to God's wisdom. The plans of the mind, verse 1, the plans of the mind and orderly thinking belong to man. Mm-hmm. But from the Lord comes the wise answer of the tongue. He said, I don't care what you thought up. I don't care how great you think it is. Don't you open your mouth and talk about it till you talk to me. That's what he's saying. He says, all the ways of a man are pure in his own eyes. In other words, when you come up with an idea, a plan, in your own eyes it's perfect, or you wouldn't do it. Amen. Nobody really sits down unless they're a little, you know, psychotic, smoking weed or drunk or something. You know, they do weird stuff. But most people in their right mind, they come up with a plan, they think that's good. Even if it's not, they think it's good. Right? Come on, prove that, Pastor. Last person you was in a relationship with. You thought it was good until it wasn't. You thought it was perfect until you discovered he wasn't or she wasn't. That's your mind. That's your idea. That's your plan. You didn't seek God. You didn't talk to God about it. You were in love. Matter of fact, you fell in love. Now, I don't think people should fall in love. I think biblically, scripturally, you should really grow in love, not fall in love. But you don't know that because, you know, they don't teach that in school, and your parents ain't going to tell you that. And if you don't know God, you won't even know anything about what I just said. You learn from TV, movies, records. Mm-hmm. You believe all that stuff they say, and 98% of it can't be true. We're going to make love all night long. No, you're not. No, you're not. I don't even think you really want to. I mean, it's going to be painful for somebody. That, what you going to do the next day? You ain't going to work. You're tired. I mean, we don't think about what we say, but you hear them songs, and I'm just telling you how we get this flawed thinking, man. We hear all kind of stuff, and if you like it, you keep it. I remember watching John Travolta in this movie, and I forget the name of the movie now. Saturday Night Fever, and the Bee Gees were playing. Remember that song? Dun, 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 when it came on, and so the movie was shot with him watching his shoes as he was walking to the club. That was my walk into the club. I would hear that song in my mind, and that's the way I would walk in the club. Y'all know. Y'all did kind of stuff. You ain't know no better, man. Huh? You ain't know no better. We're following somebody else's vision for something. We hadn't heard from God. I didn't even know who God was. So how much of who you think you are was formed by man and you or God? Now, here's why you need to change. The scripture says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove or demonstrate what is that good, acceptable, and what? So this is why we need to change. Don't have no carryovers from the old you to the new you. Amen? Here's the blessing. So, verse 2. All the ways of a man are pure in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the spirits, the thoughts, and intents of the heart. That's why it's more profitable for us to always seek God and his wisdom rather than just following our plan, because God looks beneath the surface of the need. You and I can be moved or motivated to do something just because of the need we see. But God can see beyond the need. He can see our greed. And he didn't want us connected to something without the right intent. Are you listening? Roll your works. This is one of the most powerful scriptures you'll ever hear in church. Roll your works upon the Lord, commit and trust them wholly to him, look at this, folks, he will cause your thoughts to become agreeable to his will, and so shall your plans be established and succeed. Now, here's what he's doing practically. I'm thinking something. God working as my partner. Say, yeah, son, I like the way you're going, but you're going the wrong way. Let me show you, let me direct you so that you can accomplish. I'm talking about people trying to accomplish the will of God. But you're trying to do it your way, not my way. So he'll begin to make adjustments. The steps of a righteous man are what? Ordered by the Lord. That means he's making these. Sometimes it's not big adjustment. You ain't way off, you're just off. Anybody ever been there? I mean, you're new. Sometimes I'll use me for an example. I ain't going to get mad with me, get upset with me, stop speaking to me because I don't like what me had to say about me. So I ain't talking about you. I'm talking about me. So there's been times where, you know, I knew the will of the Lord, but, well, it'd make me look better if I just kind of moved it to the right a little bit. It'd be a little easier in my eye if I kind of just, you know, I ain't sliding all the way to the left, but, yeah, I move it just a little bit. Well, if you're submitted to God, when you are thinking about making that little bit of shift that you think and have convinced yourself is not going to make that much difference, that's when he stops you. Oh, son, let me show you a better way. And he continually, consistently does that. Sort of like the way your GPS work. You put in the destination. We got really smart ones today. Not the old ones. The really, really smart ones, if there's trouble ahead, what does it do? It recalculates. Destination hadn't changed. But we have a tendency, because of how we live, how we choose, and how we allow situations and circumstances to affect us, We forget he's God, he's bigger, he's smarter, he sees it all at the same time, and he knows how to reroute you so that you don't come nowhere near the trouble, or the trouble don't come nowhere near you. Now, you sitting there, some of y'all, I'm going to get back to the natural, your computer trying to recalculate you, but you don't trust it. Because you don't see the trouble. So what do? You end up right in the midst of the trouble. It was trying to get you to avoid the trouble. But you thinking, man, it's going to take me a long time to get there that way. Yeah, but you will get there. You keep going the way you're going, that situation may cause you to never get there. He said, I will call. To me, that's powerful. God said, when you submit to me, when you really make me first, I will cause your thoughts to line up with my will. The Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. We don't make decisions. We don't act until we first think. And if our thinking is off, I mean, let's look at raising children. How many of you ever wanted to just kill one of them little jokers? No, I'm not talking about, like, you know, you were a little upset. I'm talking, at this point, you're full, you're done, they're disobedient, they're rebellious, they even swinging at you. I mean, you're just done. You know, I brought you in this world, I will take you out of this. You know, you there. But you have another thought. That's the grace of God. Not grace because you need it, grace because they needed it. That's mercy for them coming through you to them. Some of y'all looking at me like, no, I've never had that thought. You're a lie. Or they hadn't been around long enough to take you there. I ain't raised you that way. Well, you know, they've been raised by other influences also. Can't just depend on what you said to them. Yeah, I had to learn that as a pastor. Let me show you how ignorant I was. It's true. I thought that, you know, everybody that came to the church, joined the church, I thought, you know, I'm their pastor. I mean, I pray this little prayer up here. It's what I mean. It's what God said to me. I thought everybody heard what I said and knew that that's what I was committed to them doing. Therefore, I thought when I said something, that's exactly what they went home and did. I didn't know they took what I said and then compared it to this guy and that guy and that preacher. And I didn't know they had preachers that they favored more than me. That just concept didn't cross my mind until a few years ago. I've been doing this I've been pastoring over 32 years. I'm talking maybe 5-6 years ago that I finally got it. They ain't really listening to you. Some are, some not. And then sometimes they do it, sometimes they don't. I didn't get it until Jesus made me realize they don't listen to me either. He said, and I died on a cross for them. What you gonna do? Oh, like, I give up. I yield to the Spirit of the Lord. We got to control this thing. Or at least we can't control it, but God can if we submit to him. Well, you're not going to submit to him until you make him first. Are you with me? So he said he will cause your thoughts to become agreeable to his will. When I see the word cause, that means he's going to face your resistance to change with a greater force, and you're eventually, if you stay with him, going to have to submit to the greater force, which is him. Cause it. Not ask it, not wait on it. You know, cause it. Come here, man. Let me show you something. Now, I can ask Deacon James to move, or I can cause him to move. Right? What if I ask him to move? Now, I've got to depend on him deciding whether he want to move or not. Face that way. Yeah. No, that way. So, now, I want you to be stubborn, rebellious. You know, you might move one day, but I need you to move now. So, yeah. So think about that. When God tell you to do something, what are most people say? What most people say? They got to pray about it. Well, according to this scripture, he's going to cause your thoughts. Watch this now. This is really good. I don't want you to miss it. He says, he will cause your thoughts to become agreeable or to submit to his will. He ain't waiting on you to agree. He said, if you put me first, I'm going to cause your thoughts to agree with my will. That's like me telling him to move south, and he's trying to decide when is he supposed to move, how he's supposed to move, or I just move him. This is causing. He ain't got no choice. I got to hit him hard because he's a little heavier than me. I'm just messing with you, man. Thank you. That's the point. All right? He's going to cause. Can you see resistance? Doesn't matter. You can't. When God is causing your thoughts to be agreeable to his will, not for his benefit, but for yours. Not for his. He's all right. He's good. Because he's God. That's a perfect place to be. That's where I'm living my life. In that place where, man, I'm so submitted that even if I'm trying to get it wrong, don't raise your hand, but how many of y'all been working hard to get it wrong? We got a few of them in here. It's right. God made it right. But now, you know, it's right, and you're ignoring that he made it right. And we do that. I mean, I've seen people come here so broke, busted, They were disgusted with everything. And then God started blessing them. Their life starts to improve. Things start getting better. And then they forget God. He said, so that your plans, now your plans are his plans. How can two walk together except they? It's when we submit to what he's causing, that's what brings the agreement, and that's what perfects the plan. Are you with me? All right. Now let me finish with this. Go to 1 Chronicles chapter 20, 22. Here's a great illustration, 22 and verse 17. 1 Chronicles 22 and verse 17. Whew, time is running out. For sake of time, I can't read it all, but I need to read a little bit of it. This is about David and Solomon. And here's something that God was showing me about where a lot of Christians are today. This happened with me personally in ministry years ago. And God began to show me, well, he asked me some questions. First of all, he said, what if everything I've asked you to do, everything that you've done, I didn't really do it for you. It wasn't about you. It was so that you could prepare something for others. For your children, for other people's children, for the future of my kingdom. It has nothing to do with you. I called you to lay the foundation so that what I've called others to do can be built on it. He said, what would you do with that? I said, Lord, I'd be thankful that you were willing to use me at all. Are you listening? Because see, sometimes what I've discovered is people are in the pursuit of their own greatness. They call it ministry. They call it obedience to God. But really, they're looking for something that's going to make them great and not God. So this story is about David and Solomon. And the reality is that David went out and he killed Goliath. And from him having the courage to face Goliath and kill Goliath in the name of the Lord, because he defied the armies of the one true and living God. His affection, his commitment was to God, not to be king. He didn't even know what the reward was. Once they told him, he was like, oh, yeah, well, the day his head is coming off. David went out and killed Goliath. And the story is David continued to destroy the enemies of God. And his desire, because of how God had blessed him with victory after victory after victory, his desire was to build God a house for the Ark of the Covenant to be housed in. But at this point, God says to David at one of his greatest, after many, many triumphs, many, many victories, God said to David, you can't build my house. You can't build my house. You got blood on your hands. But your son Solomon can build my house. And the thing that blessed me more than anything was David's attitude and response to God. It took humility for David at that point to look at everything that had been built and established that he thought God was going to honor him and let him build a house. I said, no, 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 you can't build a house. You got all the money together, all the materials together. You destroyed the enemies that would try to tear the house down. He said, but you can't build it. Solomon's going to build it. Now, he could become envious of what God was going to do with Solomon, or humility. Everybody say humility. Humility will allow him to be truly victorious in the things of God. That's putting God first, not his own ambition. A lot of folks are so ambitious. My sis, are you ready? Now, I got to kind of summarize this, folks, because, you know, it's chapters. But you'll get the point. So in 1 Chronicles 22 and verse 17. So David also commanded all the princes of Israel to help Solomon his son, saying, "Is not the Lord your God with you? And has he not given you peace on every side? For he has given the inhabitants of the land into my hands, and the land is subdued before the Lord and his people." So David is saying, you know, he's submitting to God's will to honor that Solomon was going to build a house, not him. And he's celebrating the fact that I've destroyed all the enemies. He's not envious. He's not jealous. He's saying, I'm honored to do this. And then he's telling all the princes, join with Solomon. You followed me, now follow my son. He says, now set your mind and heart to seek, require of, and inquire of, and require as your vital necessity. Now that's putting God first. First things first. Everybody say it. First things first. So the question is God your vital necessity? Or is money your vital necessity? Or is networking your vital necessity? Because if he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. He said, the Lord your God, arise, build the sanctuary of the Lord God, so that the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord and the holy vessels of God may be brought into the house built to the name and renown of the Lord. That's a great testimony of a man that has spent his career with God to do something that God said, no, I don't want you to do it. I want you to prepare for somebody else to do it. How many of you can God say that to? How many of you would be ticked off at God and then start talking back to God? Look at all I've done. Look at what I put together. Look at all our money I put in it. Look at the connections I've made. Look at the enemies I've destroyed. You know what David came to the point of realizing? Nothing that he had done, nothing he had stored up, nothing he had obtained, he couldn't have done any of that without God. So can God speak to you about doing something different than what you thought he called you to do? Can he, let me say it another way. Can he clarify it to the umpteenth degree of details that, yeah, the house is going to be built, but I don't want you to build it. I want your son to build it. Can he do that? Or would you begin to rebel against God? Now, how did it get this way? Well, how did David, and this is what I want you to see. Go to chapter 21. I want you to see where David developed this type of humility. Because here's what I know. Either you humble yourself or humiliation will humble you. I found that with a lot of Christians, man, you know, they only want to do the big thing. God can't trust them to do a little thing or what they think is little. There ain't nothing little. Let me tell you something. If God involved, it's big. If God say vacuum the floor, that's just as important as me preaching the message, because it's what God said to do. Here's a very interesting insight into how David got to become truly a man after God's own heart. A man that God could speak to and change a plan, and he not walk away from God. You ready? All right. 1 Chronicles 21, verse 7. Oh, boy. And God was displeased with this reliance on human resources, and he smote Israel. Now, backstory. David had victory after victory after victory. David was so victorious in destroying his armies, David began to thought, as old folks say, he was smelling himself. Mm-hmm, true. David began to talk about and think about how great he was as a warrior and how great his armies were. And David began disobedience to God. David began to number his soldiers. He was counting up the number of soldiers that he had, and he was determining in his own mind that he was great and his armies were great because of the numbers that he had. And the thing he did displeased the Lord because David was going from trusting God to trusting human resources. Now, this is David now having to face God and the retribution or consequences of his disobedience without grace. You and I, we have grace. David didn't have no grace. Look at verse 8. Are you with me here? And David said to God, I have sinned greatly because I have done this thing. But now I beseech you, take away the hateful wickedness of your servant, for I have done very foolishly. What do you notice immediately? He was honest. He didn't do like some of y'all, well, I made a mistake. No, please, you sinned. You wicked. You chose wickedness over righteousness. I mean, we pretty stuff up. That's why I was using those terms that I was earlier. I don't need to repeat them. But because we've changed the terminology, we think we've changed the action. We make it sound good, but it's still the same sin. But David didn't do that. David demonstrated or showed what? Humility. That's what made him a man after God's own heart. And the Lord said to Gad, David's seer, or David's prophet, he said, go tell David, thus saith the Lord, I offer you three things. Choose one of them that I may do it to you. Now check this out. And here's where a lot of Christians are today. You know, you can't correct people today. You may as well give them a pink slip. Just tell them bye. Don't try to correct them. They don't want to hear no correction because they don't think they can ever be wrong. Here's what God did. This is a test of humility. How many of you know God could have told David? But he didn't. God told the prophet. He told the prophet to go tell David. That's what the seer is. He told the prophet, you go tell David. But now, for David, the king, to listen to correction from the prophet, he better be in humility. I've noticed it here in this church. I've been pastoring this church 26 years. 26 years, that's a long time. And, you know, there are people that have come to me, Brother Leroy, they telling me what they believe God wants them to do, and it's time for them to be promoted, and blah, 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 blah. And I had this one guy, he told me, he said, now whatever God tell you to tell me to do, I'm going to do it. I said, all right. So God told me, go tell him to go serve Pastor Joe as a PPA. Well, he didn't see that was preparation for being a pastor. He lasted a week. Came back to me and said, I can't do it. I said, what do you mean you can't do it? Joe, you do it, just do what he tell you to do. He said, I can't do it. You know why? Because in his own mind, by his own thoughts and his own reasoning, he was already superior to Joe. So he could not view or see himself in his mind submitting to Joe. He wasn't really submitting to Joe. He was really submitting to God. Who Joe didn't care one way or the other. It ain't none of his business. He didn't know. He didn't even know why the guy was coming there. He didn't have a clue. How many times have you missed God when he was trying to set you up for greatness because of your unwillingness to submit to the voice that he sent to give you the directions. Now, don't become one of them Christians where if you don't get it from this person, it's got to come from that person. You know, they're folks, I'm convinced, man, they died because they were waiting on me to come pray for them. No, I'm serious as I can be. When God told me to tell this person to go pray for them, but because of their pride, or because, you know, pride will cause you to see or to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. It's like if pastor don't come, what do you want? You want to see me or you want to be healed? You know, there's people that wonder why I don't lay hands on folks all the time. Well, the Bible says, Jesus said, lay hands suddenly on no man. I only lay hands on people when the Lord speaks to me and say, okay, I'm going to anoint your hands and I want you to pray for people. Now, that's from this side that way. Now, if God speaks to you concerning healing and laying on the hands, you got scripture for that. All you have to do is come and ask. That's why I stand here after every service, don't I? I stand right here. I get through preaching, I stand right here. If nobody comes up, then I leave. But did nobody tell me that? Well, you don't know how to hear God. Otherwise, it's just religion. You understand what I'm saying? Well, Pastor Poe, he's just so hard to meet with. Really? I'm standing right there. He got them bodyguards around him. Those guys ain't going to stop nobody from approaching me. They don't do that. They never have. That's not why they're there. They're not there to protect me. They're there to protect the anointing and the purpose of God. It doesn't do with me. I don't need no protection. Are you listening to me? But because you hadn't heard from God, you make assumptions. Are you listening? All right, let me finish. So here's what he told him, verse 12. He said, either three, he told him to make a choice, right? The prophet told him, here's your choices, David, because of your pride. He said, either 3 years of famine, 3 months of devastation before your foes, while the sword of your enemy overtake you, or else 3 days of the sword of the Lord and pestilence in the land, and the angel of the Lord destroying throughout all the borders of Israel. Now, therefore, consider what answer I shall return to him who sent me. How many of you know all three of those are bad? One of them is worse than the other two. You know what's interesting to me? Is David chose the one that, when you read it, is the worst. And David said to Gad, verse 13, I am in great and distressing perplexities. Man, I'm confused. This is jacking me up. Look what he said. Let me fall, I pray you, into the hands of the Lord. That's the one where the most, according to what was said, that's the one where the most trouble gonna come. But here's something David knew that humility reminded him of, and this is what I mean about putting God first. Even when things look bad, put God first. He said, I pray you into the... let me fall, I pray you, into the hands of the Lord, for very great and many are his mercies. Here's what David knew, and he only knew this because of humility and his love for God, and he knew God loved him. He said, I can at least pray and expect God to be merciful. I know my enemy is not going to be merciful. What are you saying? Because some of you have not put God first, kept God first, you forgot that God is your only resource when mercy and grace is what you need to get you out of whatever you're in. Are you listening to me? Some of you, you got in trouble going to the world, getting counsel, getting resources. Now you're going back to another part of the world. I call it a department. You go from one department of Satan's kingdom to another department of Satan's kingdom, trying to get help, trying to get relief, trying to get resources, when the problem really is, as a believer, you can only go to God, and you've not gone to him. So David demonstrated humility. He went to God. He went to God. And he said, maybe he'll be merciful. I can tell you right now, the enemy will never be merciful. Don't keep digging that hole. Amen. Digging ain't gonna get you out the hole. I call worry digging. Fear digging. The Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Man, I'm gonna trust God. If I got it right, I'm gonna trust him. If I got it wrong, I'm gonna trust him. If I missed him, I'm gonna trust him to get me back to where I need to be. There is no safety bailing out and hoping the devil gonna help you. That's pride. Pride coming before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. You know, there's some stuff you can't fix. And the only fix is to trust God. It's to yield. Yield to God. Finally, make him first. Finally say, you know what? I can't do this. Lord, I need you. I need you. I need to make you a vital necessity in my everyday life. Here's what God will do, and he'll do it every day. I read the scripture where he says, you know, it's sufficient unto thee today is the trouble thereof. God showed me this, folks. The only time we as Christians are worried and stressed out and bothered by whatever the trouble that's been presented to us is when we borrow trouble from the future. He said, because every day, I'm going to give you an anointing sufficient to keep you in a place of peace that day. And the next day, it's a day that I've made. And I got joy for you. I got grace for you. I got mercies. I got benefits that abound for every day. Amen. What's going to make 2017 your best year ever? Finally, you're going to put God first. Put him first. You get anything out of the word today? Yeah. Amen. Praise God. Well, stand to your feet. Glory be to God. I'm so happy you stayed to hear what God had to say today. Amen. It is so important, folks. You know, play church ain't gonna cut it. Ain't gonna cut it. You gotta be real. You gotta be authentic. You gotta hear from God. And you gotta stay submitted to what you heard. I love that particular analogy and that story because to me it really paints a clear picture of where a lot of people are. we've made decisions that don't line up with God, don't line up with our own desires. And some of you feel trapped, like there's no way out. That's not true. The things which are impossible to man are made possible by God. And if God be for you, and he's on your side, let him do what God do. Amen? Trust him. Pastor, I don't know how he's going to work this out. That's okay. You don't have to know. You just have to believe. And if you believe, eventually, you'll know. Amen? Very quickly, if you're here today, you're not saved, you're not born again, say, Pastor Paul, it sounded like you were talking about somebody I want to be. We call it getting saved or giving your life to Christ. If you're not saved and you want to be saved, or you want to start a new life, just like I did 33 years ago, then let us pray with you. Introduce you to Jesus. So if that's you, I want you to raise your hand and we'll pray with you. Anybody here? Secondly, if you're here and you say, Pastor, God has laid it on my heart to join this church. I believe Revealing Truth Ministries is where God would have me to be, to learn and to grow. That's all about. God said in the book of Hosea, chapter 6, he said, my people perish because of a lack of knowledge. Why are Christian marriages failing at the same rate or percentage of heathens' marriages? Lack of knowledge. Why are Christian children going through the same junk that heathen children are going through? Lack of knowledge. That's all it is. Not because the devil is meaner, badder, busier. No. He's defeated. God is victorious, but if you don't know that, and nobody's teaching you that and showing you how to stay focused on that, then that's why we have and see the things that we do. We're Christians. So if God has laid it on your heart to join this church, then I want you to raise your hand. We'll pray with you. Thank you. You may put your hand down. If you've not received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence speaking in other tongues, I encourage you, if you've never heard of it, let us open the Bible and show you how to receive that gift. It is your personal prayer language. I know there are theologians and doctrines that they don't believe it today, and that's okay. That's fine with them, fine with me. However, I believe what God put in the book is what he intended to put in the book. And when it comes to receiving the gifts of the Holy Spirit, well, the Holy Spirit's still here. I think his gifts are still here. So if you'd like to receive that gift, when you raise your hand, we'll pray with you. Or if you say, Pastor, I just don't understand it. Can somebody explain it to me? Well, we can do that too. Amen. All right. Amen. But there's three things: salvation, joining the church, baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you raise your hand or God spoke to your heart, come and join me at the altar. Everyone else, turn to your left, your right. Ask the person next to you the same questions. Sometimes all a person needs is somebody to say, hey, I'll go up there with you, man. I'm not scared. I'm not fearful. We don't let fear dictate us to what we do.